Rice University, where we keep the buildings low and the GPAs high. It's General Physics 2. Today, dipoles, and the electric field. Dr. Stenson. Also, a top 10 list. And now, the man who codes my SSML. Professor Hafner.
Suddenly you're happy. Give away half the exam points. All right, welcome back. It is Thursday, I believe. And this is the week we are covering charge and the electric field. So last time was largely charge. This time will largely be the electric field. I thought I'd start by just covering this problem we did last time, because I felt like we really rushed the final seconds of it. But we pretty much did it. We were thinking about how when you have two charges, Coulomb's law tells you the force between the charges. So we said, well, what if we had this dipole configuration that we'll be talking about a little bit more, and a positive charge up here, negative charge down here, and separated by D, centered on the origin of an XY coordinate system. And we put another charge out here, big Q. And we said, what force does it feel? Okay, because just doing two point charges is pretty boring. I mean, KQQ over R squared, there's not much you can do. So the dipole makes it more interesting as we get into our arrangements of charges. So we said, okay, let's think what we had to do. Well, there's this whole spherical Cartesian issue. So you kind of have to think about each force and lay it onto the Cartesian coordinates and then think about how they add up. You can't just write one equation to do it all at once automatically, because Coulomb's law is inherently spherical and we tend to work Cartesian. Anyway, so you look at it and you say, okay, well, each individual force I can figure out because it's on along the line between them. So I'll call this F plus, that's the vector force from the positive little q, and I'll call this F minus, the vector force from the minus little q. This all I think is already in your notes. That's why I wrote it ahead of time. You can decide if you want to redraw it. And we know that what you'll really get is a vector sum of these two forces. And since everything's all symmetric, you know, they're gonna be at the same angle below the horizontal, and they have the same magnitude. Basically, the F plus X and F minus X are gonna cancel. You know, one will be this, one will be this, cancel out. But the F plus Y and F minus Y, those are gonna sum. So if you really want the whole thing, we gotta add up those two Y components. That's what we were doing. I think what we did. What do you need to understand about radial coordinates? I mean, they're spherical. You mean spherical. You just have to not freak out when I write that. You just have to look at that and say, that means the force is radially outward from the point charge. And I'm cool with being able to do this. That's really all you need to be able to do. I'm just acknowledging that it exists. Otherwise, it causes confusion. So we got to add up these Y components. So, well, first you needed the magnitude. Turns out they're the same, because it's the same amounts of charge at the same distance, right? So I'm saying the magnitude of F plus and the magnitude of F minus are the same. KQQ, and that was R squared when we did a little Pythagorean stuff. But we know that what we want, the total charge, and this is a notation I use, and I think the books use it. If you see like the force and one thing dash other thing, that means the force this applies to this. This is the force that the little q's apply to the big q. Usually I use it when there's just two things. So here my little q means both of them. I could have put q's, but we're getting a little hard to read. So the force that the little q's apply to big q is just the vector sum of those two. And we talked about how you really just sum the y components because the x components cancel. So here's the whole thing. There's two because there's two y components, right? That's what that two is. These are the magnitudes, and it's just convenient that they're the same, so that makes the expression nice. And this is the sine theta, which we showed last time. Right? So if that's theta, and here's a right triangle, opposite over hypotenuse. D over 2 over I'm sorry. Oh yeah, yeah, d over 2 over the hypotenuse, and the hypotenuse is that, right? So it's all fine. Everybody, take a breather, it's all fine. Or me, take a breather. So you combine that, and then you get what we were asked to find. What is the force of the Qs, the little charge, the little Qs on the big Q? You combine that, these twos go away, and you basically get K, D, Q, Q. We can put those up there, so it looks kind of like Coulomb's law, if that makes you feel better. Although the first time you saw it was Tuesday, so I don't think you have like some deep connection to it yet. Maybe you do. And then these two things are the same inside the parentheses. It's just to the one half. I'm sorry, it's to the one times to the one half. So you add the exponents, it's to the three halves. D over 2 squared plus x squared to the 3/2. And that's the force. But now we got to think. We are doing this as a force, so we do have to think about directions and report it correctly. So the proper way to report it now is to say it's down in the y direction. So y direction is j hat, and it's down. I got to put the negative sign in myself. Okay? And you may say, now why doesn't the math give us the negative sign? It's this whole, these are radial forces, spherical, I'm using your word, spherical forces. They are radially outward, yes. And we're having to convert them to Cartesian. So that's why we are putting in negative signs around here. That's just how you have to do this. Okay, so that's why I'm manually putting in that negative sign. Let's see. So that's the force. Now, you're not always going to have to use a lot of unit vectors. You know how we roll in this class. We'll probably say, you know, tell us the force, and if it's down, make it negative, right? We'd say something like that on an exam. We're not real big into the technicalities of unit vectors. Yeah, let's just think a minute about what we found here. We have found the force on this charge, but in what limit? Right? We haven't found the force everywhere. We've just found the force, but we have found it anywhere on the x-axis. Right? We have this force, everything's constant as a function of x. And we were limited ourselves to the x-axis, and we've made all these decisions like, okay, these are at the same angle, and this component and the other components cancel. That's when we really were saying this has to be on the x-axis. If we go up here somewhere, then those things won't be true. And also this hypotenuse won't simply be this. Right? You'd have to have x and y in there. So we really did, we solve for the force along that axis. And then another thing we'd like to do is to think about, like this is very complicated. What would it look like if it went far away? When you're close, it's basically the problem of two charges on the axis and we kind of have a triangle going. But we also like to think about this thing as a dipole. And think of a dipole as an object, like the physical chemists tend to do. If this is like an object, a single thing, a dipole, then it'd be interesting to say, hey, what's the field around a dipole? You'd say, oh, well, it's this. In fact, if you remember what I said about dipoles, they're equal to QD. So we could just say it's KQ times the dipole over all that. But another thing to think is, what if X becomes much bigger than D? Okay, so dipoles in like a molecular system, really small, you know, they're like the size of an orbital often, the dipole moment you make. So it's essentially the D is very small. So usually you're like really far. So an interesting question is, how does this force fall off as you get really far away? Right now it falls off with this complicated constant plus x squared to the 3/2. But if x is much bigger than D, then this term is basically not here. Okay, so it's like a trillion, and this is 0.01. So who cares about the 0.01? So if we take that away, then it's x squared to the 3/2. So what is it? It's over x cubed. So if you do that, then the force would be minus, what do we got? K, D, Q, Q over just x to the x cubed. Okay. So that's just kind of interesting that a point charge, the force falls off as 1 over x squared, or 1 over r squared, if that's the distance. Whereas for a dipole, it falls off faster, which kind of makes sense because, you know, you're, it's like they're kind of canceling out. It's just a separation of charge. It's not an entire charge. So the force due to the dipole falls off faster than the force due to a charge. That's just some physical intuition for you. This is the actual calculation thing that, you know, you would do. Okay. So I just wanted to finish that one off, make sure you had all the the decoration that goes on it, and the deep insight, life-changing moments. The dipole is a moment, so that was a okay. Now, all we've talked about so far are forces between point charges and a little bit about dipoles, right? But what we want to talk about now is something else. The electric field. And what is the electric field? I'm going to give you two definitions of the electric field, two ways to think about it. But first, we're just going to draw and think a little bit. Let's put a big old charge right here, plus Q. And we have our magic hand situation. It's fixed. It's not going anywhere. Even if we think about there might be forces on it, it's just there. We have a big charge sitting in space. And we say, what if a little charge shows up right here, plus Q? So what's going to happen to that little charge? Think about it for a second. See if you can decide what is going to happen to that little charge. It's coming up to another charge. Charles de Coulomb would say there's going to be a force on it, right? And radial coordinates, opposite adjacent, equal attract, Paula Abdul, it's going to be a field repulsive force, like that. All right, it's going to be like F. And if we wanted to keep our notation, we could say that's a big Q on a little Q. Fine. Love it. What if it were here? Oh dear, it got real close. What would that force look like? Again, the line between them, repulsive, it's going to be much bigger force, right? Longer vector, bigger force. Right, there it is there. Yeah. What if a negative charge showed up right there? Ah, closer than that one, bigger, not that close, somewhere in between, and also attractive force. F, Q, Q. And you may be thinking, you know, in addition, there's going to be forces on big Q, aren't there? Eh, we're not worried about those right now. We're just thinking about what's happening to the little Q. Okay. So now we need to get into that biochemistry mode where we anthropomorphize molecules and particles. Okay. But let's just think about this for a second. Is big Q sitting there and saying, oh my God, little Q is there. Let me push there. Nothing else is going on. Okay, oh my God, okay, little Q left, it moved there. Okay, wait, hold on. We push really hard down here. Okay, wait, negative Q showed up there. Okay, let me pull over here. No, so big Q is not like watching around and applying forces to specific places because a charge showed up. Do you think that's what it's doing? Even if it were a person, is that what it would do? No, that's not what it does. It creates an electric field. So one definition of the electric field is what a charge does to space. Okay, it's sort of a weird wording way to put it. It's what it does in space. It creates an electric field everywhere in the space. And then the little Qs are just experiencing the electric field. That's all that's happening. That's all it is, okay? Don't let the word field freak you out, okay? So field just means a bunch of values through space. It can be 1D or 2D or 3D. Field really just means like function, okay? So all through space, we have something called the electric field that tells you how another charge coming nearby, coming in its electric field, will be pushed, okay? And it can be pushed away or it can be pushed towards or whatever. So we need to get into the math of this, but first, there's a good analogy for this. To do it, we have to sort of ask a dumb question, though. And you know, like as a student, if you ask a dumb question, you ask a question, you say, I'm sorry for asking a dumb question. Professors always say, there's no dumb questions. I never say that because I don't like to lie to students. They're dumb questions, okay? It's okay. I like to say, it's okay to ask dumb questions. You're just learning this, okay? But then people get upset, so I tend to say nothing. But I don't like to, I mean, there are dumb questions, okay? In some fields, there's a lot of dumb questions, like philosophy, okay? So I'm going to borrow this question from philosophy, all right? So they ask good questions too, but a lot of dumb ones. So the famous dumb question in philosophy is if A tree falls in the woods and no one is there to hear it. Does it make a sound? You now know that's a dumb question, right? Because we talked about sound. So if the tree falls and dumps energy into the air and vibrates the air, and that air vibration becomes a wave that propagates out through space, that's sound. If someone's ear is there to hear it or not, doesn't matter. It made sound. So that's exactly what's happening here. Okay, the charge, big Q, created an electric field all through space. And the electric field is there whether the little Qs show up or not. And even how much force they experience, that depends on little Q. Right? So the field is the field. And then what people feel depends on them. Just like the sound, right? So the tree fell, it made some sound, some intensity or some power was dumped into the air, and you can calculate the intensity. How much power you get on your ear depends on how big your tympanic membrane is, just like these depend on how big little Q is. So it's entirely analogous, except the field is not a wave, okay? So the field is static. There's no time dependence in the field we're talking about. When electrostatics field, I'm just kidding. There's some good questions in philosophy. Don't offend any philosophy people. Okay, so that's the analogy. So maybe you have the idea now. This thing is modifying space, okay? But now we do need like a mathematical way to describe that. And the good news is it's not very hard, okay? So what it is the electrostatic force on a charge per unit charge, okay? So the deal is that it works out, it's really easy. The reason we do it is because Coulomb's law is linear in the two charges. It's just got that little charge term there. So let's go back. This is big Q, this is little Q. How do we write F, big Q, applying a force on little Q? Well, it's Coulomb's constant, little Q, big Q over R squared. And I'll write that. Remember, the only thing you have to do in spherical coordinates is not panic when you see that. I'm just telling you it spreads out. But it's very convenient. Look, that little Q is right there. So you could say, okay, if I put one microcoulomb there, I get one Newton. If I put two microcoulombs there, I get two Newtons. If I put 10 microcoulombs there, I get 10 micronewtons, if the spacing and all that was right. Right? It's proportional. So why not say, I can figure out the force if I put anything there. All I gotta do is bring this under here. And that's what the electric field is. That's just the simple mathematical way to describe it. So the field at some point for any Q is we use the letter E, okay? I'm gonna say E of Q, and I'm saying just Q, because we're actually calculating something that doesn't really depend on little Q. Or even where it is, it's going to be all of space. So the E field just of Q, that's an important difference. A force is applied by Q, big Q, on little Q. The electric field is just created by a big Q. It's applied to everyone. You could put dash universe or something. Equals K, big Q, over R squared in the radial direction. Well, that's it. That is the electric field of a point charge. We can later, we don't do too much in this class, get into other arrangements of charge that create other fields. But this is the fundamental one. So this is the electric field of a point charge. All right. And let's see, does it work? Can we use it? Do we know what to do with it? Let's see. Well, let's go back to these situations. I mean, so now we could say, forget, well, let's just redraw this situation. We could say here, say E, the electric field is KQ over R squared. That's all positive numbers in the radial direction. So there's your E now. And now you could say, what if little Q shows up and lands right there? What's the force? So in this expression, we also now know how to calculate the force on something. I actually left something out, but it's good because it'd been way confusing. is E is F over Q equals that. So I'll write that up here. Since E is F over Q, we can always get the force on a little charge. It's equal to its charge times the electric field. That's really just reinverting what we did here. So we would say, okay, is that going to work out? Okay, then the force on this little Q is its Q times the electric field due to that thing. What is that? KQ over R squared, R hat. And yeah, that's just Coulomb's law, right? Just put this Q back over here, okay? But also, the reason I'm stressing this also will still get the direction right, okay? Because what if, like here, I put the negative charge there? Negative charge. Well, now this number, this expression will come out negative radial direction, which is that way, attractive. Okay. So yeah, if you do your radial direction, that'll solve the attractive repulsive for you. But often when we're doing things Cartesian, we just figure it out manually. But this is like a big idea, okay? To describe force interactions, we often use fields, like the field concept. Same thing for gravity. We didn't quite go this deep on you last semester, but it's the same thing. Okay. So let's play with an electric field a little bit. Let's see if we can figure some stuff out. Let's go with Cartesian. It's a little, not really a formal practice problem, but you know, let's say we had something like this. Cartesian axes, x, y, we love Cartesian, and we've got a microcoulomb at the origin, right there, and we've got another microcoulomb at x equals 10. One microcoulomb here at 10 meters, whatever, and this one's at the origin, okay? So that's it, two positive, one microcoulomb charges, whatever, I can't get the positive in it. And the question is simply, where is E zero? Where would the electric field be zero? So if you were a purely mathematical thinker, you would think, I should be able to write down an equation for this and add it to an equation for that, because we know that fields add. By the way, electric fields add, they superpose. This plus this equals zero and solve for the position. And you can't do that because these are radial and we're trying to do this Cartesian. You can do it purely radial, but then that's not the kind of math we like to do in this class. So instead, because of the whole radial Cartesian thing, we just have to kind of think about where could it be zero? So we're kind of pushing you to think along this axis, but you could go off in two dimensions. And say, if we go above y equals zero, if we go up in this area up here, is it possible that you could ever have zero? Let's think, what would this one look like? It look like that, would this look like that, like that? So those are gonna sum, the horizontals might cancel, but you're gonna have a vertical component. And you can probably eventually convince yourself that anywhere you draw these, you're never gonna get zero up there because the y components are never gonna cancel. If one of these were negative, then maybe, yeah, there's probably a place. But since we made them both positive on this line, even if you go over here, that one is going to make a force that way. That one's going to make a force that way. See the, I'm sorry, the field. These fields are never going to cancel in the Y. So it can't be up there. Right? And what if you come down here? Same story. It'll never cancel down there. Right? So if we look at just off the x-axis, no zeros, okay? Because you'll never get the y components to cancel. So that quickly tells us, okay, it's gotta be on the x-axis, okay? So then you might say, okay, let me set up some math along the x-axis, add these two fields, set equals zero, solve for x. You could still get into trouble. Because these things are inherently radial, you can't, like we talked a little bit last time, for forces, you can't write an expression that describes it on both sides. It'll get it wrong, right? Because it won't go negative when x goes negative, because x is squared in the bottom. You have to do it manually. So we have to actually think about the three regions separately and say, could you get a zero? So left of both, could you possibly get a zero? Think about it for a second. If I go here, could the field ever be zero? I'll give you 10 seconds. The answer is no, right? Because the field due to this one on the left side, or the negative x side, is always going to point that way. The field due to that one over here is always going to point that way. They'll never cancel. Right? Left of both never cancel. So they're never zero. What about between? What if we go in here? Could you ever have a zero? Yes, right? Here, magnitudes might be different, spacing's all crazy, but at least in principle, one vector could be that way, one could be that way. Yes, a zero is possible. We're not saying where it is yet, it's all the problem. We're just trying to use this idea of jumping between spherical and Cartesian to decide where to even look. And then what about right? No. Could you have a zero? No zero. For the same reason as left. If you're over here, all the E fields are that way. They're never going to add and cancel. Okay. So that's why to do this problem, you do have to recognize that you have to set it up in the middle. It's possible you would accidentally do that. You'd say, oh, well, I know it's in the middle because they're in the same symmetry. But we might give you ones that, without symmetry. And maybe two regions will be possible. Okay, so I'm just doing the easy one to get us started. So where's zero? Somewhere in the middle. Okay, so let's see then. Now we set up our Cartesian equations, and we're going to stay in the middle. And it's going to work because we're always on one side of this one, and we're always on the other side of that one. We're going to manually put in the direction with a negative sign because we're 1D, so we can do that. All right, you guys are really hanging in there. No questions. Just riffing on philosophers with me. So if we call this one A and this one B, then we would say, okay, so E total equals electric field of A plus the electric field of B. All right, so we just got to write what are those electric fields along this x-axis. All right, so let's do A. Along here, we're just going some distance away and have some position x. We were asked where, you know, we're looking for an x position, where? Okay, 10 microcoulombs over x squared. Okay. Only one charge up there because we're doing electric fields, not forces. And to that, we need to add this one. Let's see, this one's field is going to be that way. So I'm going to put in the negative sign manually. And I'll put in the positive sign too there manually. And it's going to be K. The top, it's also 10 microcoulombs, very convenient. And what do we put at the bottom? X squared? No. This is the radial, it depends on how far you are from this one. So if you're considering position X, this is not X, this is 10 minus X. It's that distance. It's 10 minus X squared. And whatever unit you're using. So that is your total electric field in between on the x-axis. And I had to manually do some parts because of the whole spherical Cartesian thing. So this is the thing you have to solve. Right? And there's lots of algebra to do here. Let's see, in the course reviews last semester, some people wanted to see more algebra, some wanted to see less algebra. So if you're watching this, you want to see less algebra, put it on 2x. And if you want to see more algebra, put it on 0.5x. But these three equal to zero. Okay, here's my algebra. Set them equal to each other. Took one to one side, 10 microcoulombs, 10 microcoulombs, k. We have then minus x, plus x squared equals 100 minus 20x plus x squared. I also took them from the denominator to the numerator. A lot of algebra happening. And you see, oh, this one looks, don't even have to do roots. 100 equals 20x, x equals 5. There we go. Right in the middle. Right halfway between 0 and 10. Okay. That one came out easy algebraically because I set it up symmetrically. And of course, it's going to be in the middle. There's no reason one side or the other would be where the 0 is. If it weren't set up quite so symmetrically, say the charges were different, or one was positive, one was negative, it's the same strategy. Except you'd get something here that would be a polynomial, and you'd have to find the roots of it and everything. One of the roots might be outside the domain where it works, so you don't use that one. Okay, so the point of that problem, a little bit of practice playing with fields, thinking about the Cartesian aspect, etc. If you're thinking to yourself, what's the difference between doing these problems for fields and forces? There really isn't any. Okay, it's just that we're saying, what's the field here? You could also say, what's the force on a charge Q here? Mathematically, it's essentially the same thing. Okay, for these problems, if you go further in physics, you'll see the value of describing things with fields. All right, that was fun. How are you enjoying this imaginary world of electrostatics? I think 126 students will like it because they're just being told these are the rules you need to follow. Just follow these rules. We gotta do that. We gotta do it. Okay. Let's look at the E field. So that's what this means now. E with a vector on it. Next to a dipole. Right, we're kind of obsessed with dipoles in this class because this class is a little more molecular, you know. It's more greater chance you would run into dipoles than a mechanical engineer. So let's draw this dipole again. And we're going to do kind of the same problem, but we're not going to have to do all the guts again. We're going to draw our dipole on a y-axis again and think along the x-axis for now and say, what is the E field at point P? So the traditional thing to do is to call it point P and then say, what is E at point P? So in the previous problem, I should have put a point P and said, where is that zero? So there's point P. I'm not going to do it because you're just going to ask what P stands for. It means like the geometric point P. So here's plus Q and here's minus Q, right? Before we called that D, et cetera, I'll go and label it D. All right. And we want to figure out what is the electric field, the E next to a dipole, on the x-axis, like in this diagram, right? As a function of x, just like we had before. But remember, E is the force you would get over Q. So we sort of already done it. We can use our previous result. What was our previous? We already had the force. The force that the little q applied to the big Q, we'll put a big Q there, was K Q, big Q, D over D over 2 squared plus X squared to the 3/2. And now I'm doing something very unfortunate on you, but you're going to get used to it. Before, we put our big Q here. So big Q is like the test charge, okay? There's nothing magic about little Q being the one experiencing the field. I mean, you can switch those around, it's just letters, okay? So since this was big Q, we'll say the E field there is the force over that big Q. All right, I'll put a big Q there. That's where we're calculating the forces. But now that we want the E field, there's no big Q there. It's just a point in space. Okay, so if the E field is this over big Q, you can see where we're headed here. We're just getting rid of the big Q. Then the E field, due to the Qs, and now I'll put that dash, what is that? Apostrophe S, because there's two of them. The E field due to the Qs is just K, Q, D over about that, D over 2 squared plus X squared to the 3/2. And, in this case, well, if you want to do this proper in terms of vectors, it's in negative j hat direction. Just like the force, the E field will point down. So that's why if we want to write it as a vector, we'd have to put that. Or you just say down, negative y. Okay. And there you go. So that's the E field along the axis. It's very similar to the force expression. But there's some things we can do. One is, let's assume we're doing that thing we're really far away. X is much greater than D. Then we can simplify this just like before. We can say the E created by the Qs, the dipole, is minus, and then we're just going to get rid of this D thing here. Now here's a good question. Why do we get rid of it here and not here? Okay, you get rid of something that's smaller than something else when they're added. When there's a term where they're added, you can say this is so small compared to that, and since they're added, this one isn't here. This one is small, but it's like in the product of a bunch of terms, so it'll still drive the terms down, even if it's small. So that's why this becomes minus k q d over x cubed. So just like the force, the field, for once you're far away, drops down as x cubed. But we can go even further. Let's describe it as a dipole. Okay, so a dipole, you would the book's notation would be to say you have a positive here, a negative here, they're both q, and then you draw a vector, and you call it s. Okay, so sorry, that's what they do. S is the vector version of D. Why don't we call it D vector? I don't know. Contact your publisher. But that's the S vector. But that's still not the dipole, is it? No, the dipole moment is P. Dipole moment P is Q, the magnitude of the charge on each one. It's not 2Q or anything like that. It's just Q times S vector, like that. Okay. So this is the important thing. This is the dipole moment. That's what you'll be told, like, if you're doing some molecular system. And they'll say, this molecule has a dipole moment P of 2 dBi or something. There's some molecular scale unit. You can just do it in Coulomb meters. But a microscopic version is the dBi. So if you have that, where we're going with this here is notice then that P is showing up here, QD. See, QD, D is the basically the magnitude of P. So you could say that this is K times a dipole moment over X cubed. But what we're going to do is we're going to generalize. Okay, so we assumed that, we described it as a dipole, and we generalize like this. Is we're going to say that E of the dipole, maybe you'll accept this generalization, is minus K times the dipole moment over R cubed. Okay? That is a dangerous expression because you have to know how to use it. Okay? This is an expression that mixes, you're making me say radial. Spherical, oh, radial is better. It mixes spherical and Cartesian coordinates, okay? What this is saying is if I have a dipole moment and it's pointing one way up, then if I want to know the field to the side, this is only good for to the side. I'm going to put dipole perpendicular. It'll give you the field pointing the opposite direction. That's what the negative sign means. So I'm sorry, this is actually a good. This is accurate in Cartesian coordinates, as long as you stay on the side. It's telling you that if the dipole points one way, the E field it creates will point the other way. But it's only sort of like on this line perpendicular. Okay, you see that? So the dipole minus plus is this way, the field is that way. And it gives you the magnitude of the field as long as you're far away. Okay. So the reason we're deriving this and telling you is we might do dipole problems. We may say, here's a dipole and here's a dipole. What's the field here? We'll just add their two individual fields. We're not finding the dipole moment all around the dipole. Okay, that's too complicated. But we're going to give it to you in one more place. Not going to derive it, just going to tell you. Okay, just let me know. I'll draw it, I'll write it right here. It's also sort of generalized, and it is the electric field due to a dipole, and I'm going to write parallel. This is risky notation, okay? All I mean by that is along the dipole. So this will be the value anywhere along this y-axis, okay? So let's see what that looks like. It is 2k times the dipole moment over r cubed. And you can imagine we could do it, right? Get the field due to this one, the field due to this one, and add them. It'd be similar algebra. We'd take the similar large distance, and we've defined P the same. Why does it have two? Don't ask. You know, it has two. Don't worry about it. Okay. If you ask, I'll make you do the derivation. Is the point on the x-axis positive? Yeah. That's what I started to say about this one being risky. Is you're assuming you would put in a positive number here. Because yeah, if you put in a negative, our x cube would be negative. And that's the deal, is this is technically like a radial formula, or it's a cylindrical formula. So the r direction is always considered positive x. We're mixing three-coordinate systems now. So yeah. But yeah, it does matter though because of that cube. But the point is, even if you screw that up, you gotta remember the E and the P will be in opposite directions. So if you ever happen to be parallel, then you probably messed up, put something negative in there. For this one, it gives us the case that the dipole, well, is the field always points along the dipole direction. All right, so anyway, so you may use these, these are like back of the book, they're on the formula sheet, you just gotta know how to use them, okay? Let's see. Okay, it's break time. So after the break, we're gonna talk about how to do field lines and how to think about electric fields in that sense. What is that? Oh, yeah, okay, all right, so I'll see you at 10:26. From the home office at Jones College, we have the top 10 people online students have said I look like. Now, quick privilege check. I put lots of lectures online and people probably look at me and assume I know what I'm talking about. So they just sort of mess around with me and joking about who I look like. Other people aren't so lucky and they get lots of offensive comments. So if you make those, maybe just stop. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll put a link down below so you can have some idea. Anyway, since mine are just kind of funny, we're gonna go through them. Here we go. All right, top 10 people online students said I look like. Number 10. Oh, actually, there's only been 9. These are all real. So here we go. Number 9. Severus Snape.
Obviously,
yes. Number 8. The guy that voices McCree. Okay. Number 7. David Bowie. Wow, that's... that's quite a compliment there, although, you know, let's be real, they were probably talking about Ziggy Stardust. And let's be even more real, lately it's more like Ziggy Stardust on the Great British Bake Off, if you know what I mean. All right, number 6, that badass grandma from Terminator Dark Fate. All right, I take that as a compliment because she is a badass, but you should know that is Sarah Connor. She's the main protagonist of the entire Terminator movie series. Sarah Connor, you should know who that is. Next, number 5. Ego Raptor, no idea. Number 4, Madeleine Albright. I'm not gonna lie, that stung a little bit. Number 3, Captain Beefheart. All right, no idea who that was. It's a singer from the 70s. I can't imagine anybody taking my classes would know who this person is. And I don't exactly see it, so I thought, well, maybe it's more of a presence thing. So I found a video of Captain Beefheart just to see, maybe it's a voice thing or something. So let's see if it was something like that. Let's see, here's a clip of some Captain Beefheart.
Now you have an interesting name yourself. Can you tell us a little of the origin of Captain Beefheart?
Captain Beefheart, a beef in my heart against the society. Mm-hmm. They're cutting the beaks off penguins down at the marina in LA. You know that, the water. Cutting the beaks off pelicans. Cutting the beaks off the top beak.
I know, yeah. But why are they doing that?
I don't know, but I sure would like to find who's doing that.
Well, that's...
They need a spanking.
Yeah, I can see that. All right, number 2. Yara Greyjoy. Oh, another badass. I'll take it. And the number 1 person, online student, who said I look like... themselves. Okay. More, let's see, electric fields. So now we got to think about how do we have to represent electric fields. I guess I'm being fancy pants. I mean, how to draw them. Okay. So one way is a quiver plot. All right, so that means I make a plot and I like shape four. No, that's not what it means. If I was gonna make a quiver plot of the big charge Q, okay, and you now know what its electric field looks like, KQ over R squared. So its magnitude kind of goes down as you get farther away. And it points out in all directions, radial. So if I said, what is it? Say, oh, I don't know, here near the surface. Oh, it's really big. And everywhere I go, it points out. Let me draw eight of them, because this lecture is a little short. There we go. And if I get a little farther away, they're going to be what? A little shorter. Yeah. Like that. And if I go a little farther away, they're going to get a little shorter, like that. Because they're decaying as 1 over r squared. If everyone has found like classy, I heard a knight give a talk, a physicist who had been knighted. And you know, you don't say 1 over r squared. You say 1 upon r squared. If you say upon instead of over, next level, okay? So here in a quiver plot, the magnitude, as you know, as one tends to do when they draw vectors, the magnitude equals the vector length. And this sucks, okay? This is the reason we have other ways. Because basically, if the vector is really big right here, you've got to draw it into a region where it's not big. What if I tried to do like right here, really close? Okay, so it's like you need this to be really small, but indicate something really strong. So a quiver plot is not the way to do that. You don't want to do that. So that's why we don't use quiver plots so much. We use something called field lines. Yes. So let's say we had a plus Q here, and let's draw this with field lines. So all you got to do is pick somewhere to start, usually on the charge, and you draw a line along the direction of the field. And we know for a point charge like this, that the field is just radially out like that. So you just have to draw radial lines. These are lines for the entire line. It's going the exact direction of the field like that. So again, I drew eight of them. The number depends on something we'll get to, but it's arbitrary for what we're doing now. Field lines, you also want to indicate the direction. So you just put a little arrowhead like somewhere on the line, you know, it's kind of like Google Maps. It might be in the wrong place. Then you zoom in on it, you can't see like how big it is and everything. Anyway, you just need a little arrow to indicate that it's out. Okay, so let's look at some rules here. Continuous lines, no vectors. They start on a charge. And what else? the continuous vectors, they start on a charge. They're always along field direction. What else? And the arrowhead gives direction. That's kind of arbitrary. More bullet we'll get to in a minute. So that's kind of the deal with field lines. What if you're not sure in a more complicated situation what to do? Imagine a positive test charge. Oh my God, why did I use that word? Test charge. So the way we figure out an electric field technically is, you know, we said, well, it's just, you think of a force, that's the force for unit charge. That little charge you use to figure out the force, we call it a test charge, because the idea is it's not really part of the system. It's just a charge you're putting there to test. you know, what's the force there? And therefore, what is the field there? So here, if we could also do this by saying, if I put a test charge right here, positive charge, which is the force, out. Okay, continue the line that way. What if I put the charge here? A little positive test charge, force is out. Okay, continue the line that way. That's how we can figure it out. What if we wanted to do this for a negative charge? What would be different? Think for yourself for a minute. What would be different? We go back to this formula. We would say it's KQ over R squared R hat. All right. Well, if I put a negative value in here, this whole thing's going to come out negative. It's in the negative radial direction. Or you could just know from thinking of the forces that all these would change direction. Right. So now the field is the other way. Or you could also think of it in terms of the test charge. Just make it bigger. Yeah. You can think of it in terms of the test charge. Test charges are always positive. That's like our, what's that word? That's our standard, our convention. So if I put a little positive test charge here, it's going to be attracted to the negative Q, right? So that's why the field line goes this way, that way. Okay. So I think the next field bullets I'll do on the next board here. Okay. So now, you may have seen the movie. What's the movie where, that guy, he and Batman wrote it. They won an Oscar for writing it. Not the good Batman. I need some help here. What was that movie? Where he's like the poor janitor kid in Boston. Good Will Hunting, yes, thank you. So maybe you saw Good Will Hunting, right? And he's just walking up to the walls and just like doing math with graphs, and he's like a genius. Okay, one, that's total bullshit, but anyway. The people that designed the physics building thought that's what we actually do. So if you're ever in the physics building, Brockman, you'll notice the whole thing is like a big whiteboard because they wanted us to use the whiteboards and actually like do physics. I think they thought we'd just be walking down the hall and go, oh, Feynman diagrams. Yeah, like, I don't know what they were thinking. But if you walk around and you see the little things that say, welcome to Hollis's lab, welcome to Hafner's lab, those are, I think, 11 years old at this point. Like, those have not been erased for 11 years because we don't actually walk up to random boards and start. But if you ever wanted to pretend that you're in Good Will Hunting, you can draw these field lines and you'll look like you know what you're doing, okay? So let's draw the field between a positive and a negative charge. And all you gotta do is think about that test charge. Matt Damon and Ben Affleck. Took my Prevagen this morning. So if I was a positive test charge here, I'm gonna feel a repulsive force from the positive and attracted to the negative. And if I stay on this line, that's gonna happen the whole way. So there's one of the field lines. Arrow that way, because that's what a positive test charge would do. What about here? If I'm here, I'm close to this. Far from that. The force is mostly going to be from this. So my little positive test charge is flying away, but it's going to get pulled over. And if it was here, it would fly towards, really. But you're going to get a nice symmetric little line like that. Yeah, like that. What about this line? It's going to get sucked over to here, like that. What about this line? It's going away, but it'll eventually sense the negative. Like that. That'll sense the negative. That'll sense the positive. That'll sense the positive. This one will go straight out, and that'll go straight up. Right. This one, test charge, flies away. It's slowed down by the negative charge sucking it back, but it's never going to curve. So that line goes to infinity. Look at that. We'll put the arrows on it. Man, put me in Good Will Hunting. Look at that. I can act the hell out of that role. Boom. Okay. So that's how you do it. And what did I do? I just thought about a test charge. Textbook quality. Let's do another one, though, that brings up another point about magnitudes. Let's do... So that one looked easy, right? Because I did the symmetric plus Q minus Q. What if this one is 2Q and this one is minus 1Q? So it's not going to be symmetric anymore. Let's start here. I can do this line. If I'm right here, I'm still being pushed away by the plus two Q. I'm still getting sucked towards the minus Q, but I'm always gonna stay right on the axis. Okay, I'll do that line. But how are we gonna represent the fact that there's two here and one there? Well, there's more rules about field lines. So the number of lines emanating from a charge is proportional to the charge. So before I did like eight lines, right? So I like to just give a little baby start to all of them because they're always going to be perpendicular right at the surface. Don't worry about why. And on this one, I'll draw 16 because that's just how I do it. You're like, surely he's not going to draw 16. You must be new to this class. Okay. There we go. 16. So what now? We just got to connect them. The lines from here have to connect to here. So here it goes out and it doesn't care so much about the minus Q for a while because the 2Q is so much stronger, but then eventually it does. And this one really doesn't care about, oh, but it is there. And this one has to connect here. This one will connect with that one. And this one will connect with that one for real. Yeah, like that. This one, it'll go off into infinity. And these will go out and become a little bit curved because eventually that minus Q is talking to them, you know, but not much. And then this one will go that way and that one will go that way. Look at that, straight from a textbook. But the reason I'm not just drawing these to act like an idiot, like I usually would do, I'm drawing them to tell you one more thing. Number of lines emanating from a charge, proportional to charge. We haven't talked about how to get the magnitude of the field. That seems to be missing from this field line thing.
Oh, yes, but it's there.
The magnitude of the E field. I shouldn't have to write field because you know that's the E field. E is proportional to the number of lines per unit area. Okay. So, but that area is perpendicular to the board. If we're just doing nice 2D drawings here, okay. You could pretty much draw it in the plane of the board and you'll always get the answer right, but I want you to know it's actually perpendicular. So the idea is this. So say I have a nice little uniform area. I have a post-it note. Hey, look, yeah, here we go. This is my little area, the number of lines per unit area. So I would stick it like here, like this way, and it's number proportional. And here, oh, I'm getting three. And then I move out, oh, here it's only two, and here it's only one. Why is it going down? Because there's field is bigger by the 2q than the negative q. What if I take it out here? I can have one because I put it there, but here I have zero. It's really a continuum, right? The density of lines per unit area is really low out here. Because basically if you get far enough away, you know, then these kind of are canceling. Here, they're staying higher on this side. Oh, because I'm close to a 2q. Here I'm close to just a single q, so they're lower. They're nice and pretty good in the middle. So that's how you visualize the magnitude. So you could have problems where you could say, you know, here's 2 points. Where's the field bigger? Okay. Having this so qualitative may bother you. You may say, no, I would like the formulas for this. We could do it. No, it's vector calculus. That's the problem, is this number is a vector flux. So we would have to do vector calculus. Let's not. So if this sounds cool to you, you may secretly be a physicist and you just don't know it yet. And you should look through chapter 24, Gauss's Law, okay? We are describing this field stuff to you, and it's just a bunch of annoying equations and drawings, but there's like a deep hidden beauty to it. And it's connected to vector calc. And when you see it, you're like, whoa. that is awesome. But it's a lot of work to see it. So, but if you find it intriguing, chapter 24. And there's some idiot online with hours of lectures about it. Okay, there's one more kind of field we want to... Oh, we have 20 minutes. Shit. Okay. Class might end early today. Okay. Let's look at a uniform electric field. I never know if, like, if I ended early, if not getting your money's worth, and you'd be mad, or you could have done one more practice problem, or if you'd be saying, yay, I love you. Okay. I mean, I love me. I went too far. It's too early. A uniform electric field. This is just a new geometry. All we've done so far is like point charges and dipoles. So basically, a uniform electric field is just constant magnitude. And constant direction fits like the simplest possible geometry of a field. So that's why we talk about it a lot and everything. So it just looks like this. So if we were to draw with feet, well, let's draw with a quiver plot, just because this one is easy to draw with a quiver plot. Everywhere you go, there's a field pointing to the right. That's it. Want to draw with field lines, everywhere you go, there's a field pointing to the right. Or I mean, it could be the left, or I could draw them up, you know, but you get the idea. It's just a constant field. If we want to describe it mathematically, it doesn't have to be done in spherical coordinates because this is a new kind of field. Like the whole spherical problem is not a problem of electric fields. It's a problem of point charges. Point charges have the symmetry of a spherical system. So that's why their fields are spherical. These are uniform to the right, so they're more Cartesian. So if we wanted to write the electric field here, well, I'd have to do it in some Cartesian coordinate system. So I could say, okay, well, that's y and that's x. So it's in the x direction. So I'd say it's just some magnitude I hat. It's just the x direction unit vector. It's just saying a magnitude of E naught in the x direction. And that's it. Isn't that easy? That's what we do about uniform fields. What's the force on a charge? See if you can figure out what would the force on a charge be. Think about that for a second. F on a charge Q, be Q E naught. Just be a constant force to the right. So then we could also make you do kinematics problems because that's just like gravity. Gravity is a constant force down. If you have an electric field pointing down and a positive charge, it'd be exactly like gravity because we have this constant force pushing it down. So it's not proportional to its mass, but it would still be constant. So that's kind of boring. So let's find something more interesting. Let's look at the, that was force on a charge. Let's look at the force on a dipole, since we're obsessed with dipoles. Let's see. So let's draw a little dipole here. Positive. I like to draw this little boba straw to remind you that that's at a set separation. Okay, so what would that feel? Let's see. Well, property of the dipole is these are the same charge, just opposite magnitude. They're both Q. So this is going to feel a force that way, F plus. This will feel the same magnitude that way, F minus, just obviously in the opposite direction. So the force on a dipole, the total force is F plus F minus is zero. Okay, so a dipole feels no net force in a uniform field, but a little bit of 125 sneaking in, what will there be? Will nothing happen here? No, it'll cause it to rotate. So there'll be a torque. So let's calculate the torque. Force on a dipole, torque on a dipole. All right, so if you don't remember how to calculate torque in detail, it's okay. You can use the formula at the end. But for those of you that took 125, let's remember torque was RF sine theta, right? We're going to assume that we're torquing around the center of mass because this is a nice metric object. So we're going to assume the center of mass is in the center. We're going to say torque equals, well, there's going to be two forces. So let's put a two in there. We're just going to add them together. because they're going to be the same. R is that little d over 2. All right. R, F is QE. All right. Yeah, QE, not. And then sine theta. All right. So this is, there's two of them, R, F, sine theta. You may recall from some mechanics class. Okay. So I'm going to just give myself a little room up here and finish off torque on dipole. So I don't know, if we simplify that, what does it do? Oh yeah, well, so the 2.5 go away and you get QD E naught sine theta, right? But what is QD? Is P, right? So then the torque on the dipole, we can describe it as the dipole moment. P E naught sine theta, like that. And then if you want to get more mathematically fancy, we'd have to start calling these things vectors. And in 125, we didn't quite give you vector definitions of the rotational things. Technically, torque is a vector. P, we know, is a vector. E is a vector. It's looking like a cross product here. So if you're mathematically advanced, yes, it is a cross product. Okay. But for this class, we can just think of it this way. So what this would mean is if I drew you a dipole like that, you'd be able to say, oh, I could calculate the torque, because you'd say, okay, I know Q, and I know QD, or I know P, and I know this is the direction, and this is the field, there's your theta right there, okay? And then that torque, if it's positive, you'd assume, well, then we'd get into directional problems and vector torque problems, but you could figure it out by saying, well, I know this one's going to feel force that way. That's going to feel force that way. This thing is going to turn like that. So the torque tends to align the dipole with the field. Yeah, so let me put that as one more star. The dipole tends to align with E naught in this uniform field. Yeah. I say tends to align, because if you released it from rest here, it would be pushed to a line, but it wouldn't stop, it'd keep going. And then it would go this way, and then it'd swing back, and it would actually oscillate. But if you have some friction in there, it would stop itself eventually, and it would align. So I would say tends to align. It's also, well, like, compasses have water in them, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's talk about that later. Let's see. So one more thing is, how do we, I don't know what people would say, what's in drawing, okay. The one more thing is, how do we create this uniform field? Right, so we say the field comes from charge, and I didn't draw any charges, I just drew a field. So we'll do that a lot. We will just draw and say, uniform field, don't worry about where it came from. But we'll also have problems where we want to think about where it comes from. So let's look at that. So this F equals QE, there's one standard kind of problem we aren't going to do one right now, is we do kinematics. We think about a particle with a mass moving through space where it's experiencing this force. So you'll see some of those. Let's see. Okay, so one way to make, pretty much the only way, to make a uniform electric field created by charged planes plus and minus Q. Looks like I'm using big Q for some reason. There we go. Okay. So let's imagine we have a plane here and it's covered with positive charge. It's got positive charge Q, and it's got area A. That's its properties, okay? Area A, charge Q. And now we're gonna, underneath, we're gonna have another one. Like this, and it's gonna be covered with negative charge. Much easier to draw. with minus Q, and it's also area A, okay? So if you go in between here, you might be able to guess which way the field's gonna be. You can get it with a test charge. And there's a song you sing, you go, I'm a little test charge, short and stout. Okay, so a little positive charge, it's gonna see a bunch of positive here, negative here. It wants to go down, right? The force on it will be down. So since this makes a uniform field, it makes a uniform field down in the space, which I'm not drawing it well because I'm making them different lengths, sorry. Okay, so charge planes create a uniform field in between them. Okay, E field created by charge planes. So here's some bullets. You care about the charge density on each plate. Sigma is what we use for charge density. Lowercase sigma, it's usually more around. There we go. Ooh, that's beautiful. That's equal to the charge over the area, charge of the plate over the area of the plate, right? And coulombs per meter squared. So it's just another property, charge per unit area. And the planes are large or infinite compared to the separation, which I haven't given you because you actually don't need it. And then here we go. Then here's the value. So we need to give you the value of the electric field. Okay. So the direction is just obviously from positive to negative, and the E in the gap is Q over epsilon naught A. So that's all things that you have, Q, area, epsilon naught, or if you want to write in terms of sigma, sigma over epsilon naught. And I'm psychic, I can predict the questions. What is epsilon naught? No, you haven't asked yet, but you will. Epsilon naught, we talked about before, is equal to the permittivity of free space, which is basically saying it's like, how much electric field does space permit to be created for some charge? I mean, I'm making that up, but it sounds good. It's probably what it means. And it's equal to 8.85 times 10 to the minus 11. Oh dear, I think I know. Coulomb squared per meter squared newton? Nope, that's not a newton. I think, is it that? It's got a newton down here. No, it's got a newton up here. No, it's got a newton down there. I don't know. It has a unit. Look it up. Off the top of my head, I forgot. It's Coulomb squared per newton meter. No, the newton's down here. I had it right the first time. There we go. Yeah. And we haven't talked about it because it's you use it the same way you use little k. Our 9 times 10 to the 9, k equals 1 over 4 pi epsilon 9. So for some formulas, it's more convenient to use K, like Coulomb's law. For some formulas, it's more convenient to use epsilon naught. Okay, like that. Now you may be asking, why is it uniform? And is that just like on the mid-plane? And the answer is actually no. It's uniform all the way down. Even if you almost touch one of the planes, it's still uniform. And that's a little bit weird. Like, let's draw it in cross-section real quick. So if we drew this in cross-section like this, drawing actually is a little nicer to look at. Here's your positively charged plane. Here's your negatively charged plane, okay? The uniform field between them would be down. There's your field lines. Now, if this field lines are uniform, that means the magnitude here is the same as here, is here, same as here, all the way until you touch the plane. So sometimes it bothers people, where does this come from? How do we calculate this? Why is it constant? We could calculate it. We would have to do vector calculus, so we don't want to do that. Let's not do that. But it is true, you can't understand why it's constant as you go all the way down to the surface of the plane. And I usually leave that as a mystery to think about over the weekend. But I've got 4 minutes to explain it. Do you want a mystery to think about over the weekend, or do you want to explain it? First person who comments wins. Mystery. Oh, everybody wants a mystery. Ooh, mystery was first. Okay. So I'm going to leave it as a mystery. But think about it. Why? I mean, you're touching a charged plane. The field should go to infinity. Doesn't it? Stays constant. Think about that. Okay. Okay. I'll see you guys Tuesday.